Welcome to the pilot episode of the Flutter Build Show, where we'll walk you through the raw mechanics of building specific things in Flutter. In this episode, we're going to learn a lot about render objects, including when and how you should write your own. In Flutter, we love to say everything's a widget, and it's true that most things developers touch are widgets. In Flutter, any layout you can dream up is possible, and off-the-shelf widgets can almost always do the job. But almost always is different than always. And that limitation comes from a little thing called Flutter's single pass layout algorithm. This means that when Flutter is turning your widgets into an actual layout, no back and forth is allowed. But how can that be, you ask? Surely the column widget's main axis alignment property proves that Flutter does have this back and forth, right? Flutter has to know how big the children widgets are before it can place them. Surely, that constitutes back and forth during layout. Well, functionality like this is why Flutter has so many different trees, including the three most popularized ones. Widgets create the declarative API that we all know and love. Elements are the translation layer that hold it all together. And render objects handle sizing, layout, painting, and semantics from one frame to the next. So, what do render objects do? Well, a simplified day in the life of a render object might look like this. First, the render object wakes up when its widget creates it with create render object. Then, during the rendering phase, Flutter works its way through three critical methods: perform layout, paint, and describe semantics configuration. The first method is perform layout, wherein the render object has one job: figure out how big you're going to be. If the original widget had children widgets, then this render object probably asks their render objects to determine their size. This happens all the way down the render tree until everything is sized. Later on, Flutter calls paint on all the render objects, which combines their previously calculated size information with whatever other parameters they have to start making actual graphics calls. Lastly, Flutter calls describe semantics configuration, which builds out the semantics tree, which Flutter uses for accessibility. Those are the three big methods in a render object's day: perform layout, paint, and describe semantics configuration. Then things are stable, but eventually you call setState, meaning it's the dawn of a new frame. New widgets with your new values are slotted into the widget tree, and Flutter calls update render object where needed to route your new values to the render objects that need them. Each render object then re-enters its cycle of those three big methods. Only this time, it's not guaranteed that Flutter will call each one, because depending on what changed, cached values from the last frame may still be valid. It's up to individual render objects to track this, which we'll see for ourselves later. So unlike widgets, render objects are highly mutable and live for as long as possible within your app, often supporting many frames in one lifetime. So that's a high-level overview of render objects. Now, sibling UI elements cannot typically influence each other, but sometimes they have to, which specialized render objects handle with specialized implementations of perform layout and paint. Render objects are the unsung heroes of Flutter. Rows and columns use just such specialized render objects, but the rules are strict and exposed to us through the well-known main axis alignment and cross-axis alignment properties. What are you to do if you need highly tailored layout rules specific to your app? Well, the answer might be to write your own render object. One scenario that requires a dedicated render object is a common message bubble in chat apps like WhatsApp, where the sent at timestamp is rendered in the final line if it fits, but wrapped down to an additional line if it doesn't. Flutter's single pass layout algorithm doesn't cleanly allow for this UI. You could use add post frame callback to make measurements after the first frame and slot in that sentat value accordingly, but that would create UI flickers for this scenario and would look terrible. So we need a custom render object. When we're done, it'll look like this. Let's build it. To start, I've created a fresh project with Flutter create --empty to spin up a bare project. Let's fill our page with a scaffold and a centered sized column, which will begin to house our vague chat app UI. In that column, first add some padding around a text field, and above that, our chat bubble, called a timestamped chat message. To help it look a little more like a chat bubble, I'll decorate it with a helpful container and an align widget, which will push it to the right. Next, create that text editing controller we imagined in the text field to quickly test our time-stamped chat message against different values. To link the two, wrap our time-stamped chat message in a listenable builder. Use our controller as the listenable, and build our widget like normal. Lastly, we'll ultimately need three parameters for this widget: a text value provided from the controller, another text value for the timestamp, and a text style. We're now ready to work on the timestamped chat message widget. The vast, vast majority of widgets you've written in the past likely extended stateless widget or stateful widget. But this time we're going with something else, one of the descendants of RenderObject widget. To figure out which one, we need to think about the parameters we want to pass our time-stamped chat message. One alternate option would have been to accept a child widget and a date time for sent at. This is how most widgets work, of course. Lots of widgets have a child parameter, but it'll be tricky in our case because we need to perform exact measurements on individual characters and lines in the message. And that's tough to do if the raw string value is buried deep within a text widget. Plus, what would we do if the user supplied an image or a stack or something else wonky? None of those values make any sense for what we're building, which is why the appropriate constructor signature is to accept a string, a text style, and a second string. And of course, that key. The appropriate parent class when the widget in question does not have any children widgets is called Leaf RenderObject Widget. Our timestamped chat message will be the end of the road in its branch of the widget tree. If this is your first time in the render tree, you may be surprised to learn that RenderObject widgets don't have build methods. Instead, we need to supply two other methods, createRenderObject and updateRenderObject. In createRenderObject, I'll add a stub that we'll finish later. For now, this method will return a time-stamped chat message render object, a name that really rolls off the tongue. Okay, on to the time-stamped chat message render object. Again, there are different parent classes to choose from, but the right one for our case is RenderBox. This is the most common render object when your UI element will fit in, well, a box. The first thing we have to see to is our render object's constructor and the parameters it will require. Once those parameters are all saved to private variables, let's create two text painters that we will use later. The next thing to understand with render objects is how they think about their attributes. Remember how widgets are lifeless configuration objects and can never change? Well, that's not how render objects work. Render objects are like chameleons. They can change their color, size, and shape, or anything else without missing a beat. Technically, chameleons can only change one of those things, but you get the idea. For every attribute our render object accepts from the widget, we need to write a special getter and setter. The convention looks like this. For the getter, simply proxy to the private variable we set in our constructor. And for the setter, first evaluate whether the items are the same, and if they are, return. That's called a guard statement, where you check short circuit conditions at the top of a method and return early. And it's how render objects in Flutter are written. After that guard statement, we know the value is new. Here, assign the new value to the private variable. We'll also need to update our text painter, but remember that it took a text span. To help ourselves, let's make text span getters for both our core message and our sent at value. Later, we'll return to these magic setters and update some flags, but don't worry about that yet. Just remember that we'll be back here. We need getters and setters for all of our attributes, so let's add them quickly. With the setters in place, we can finish createRenderObject and updateRenderObject in our widget class. For updateRenderObject, remember that widgets are immutable, so if any values have changed, the old widget is long gone, and Flutter will call this method on its replacement. This new widget has no pointer to the original widget's render object, so Flutter passes it in to updateRenderObject. We can now make use of the setters we just wired up to apply the new text, style, and sent-at values. It's up to the render object to work out what, if anything, to do with those. Okay, a lot of our code is in place, but sadly, we still can't run the app and see anything, And that's because we have yet to implement the three critical methods in our render object: perform layout, paint, and describe semantics configuration. We'll start with perform layout, as it comes first. Perform layout's job is simple: determine the dimensions of whatever we're rendering and save it to the size attribute. For render objects with children, you should call child.layout and then interrogate its size. But that's not our scenario. We don't have any children widgets. We're a leaf node in the widget tree. Now, the upcoming sizing and measuring code gets a little nitpicky, and it's somewhat zoomed in for our purposes here learning about generic render objects. I'm going to quickly breeze through it, but know that the full, thoroughly commented source code is linked below. So, to layout text, call textpainter.layout and supply a maximum width, which we can pull from constraints.maxWidth. At this point, our text painter will know its size, but we need more granular information, like the length of the longest line and the length of the last line. To access this information, call textpainter.computeLineMetrics, which returns a list of line metrics objects. We're close now. We can set up a few variables to save values for later, and then a little manipulation of that line data pulls out the other info we need. We can now save a helpful variable called sizeOfMessage based on the longest line and the number of lines, and we'll use this later. You might guess what comes next. Repeat this same process with our sentAt text painter and measure its size. Now we can compare whether or not those two widths can squeeze into constraints.maxWidth, which sets the all-important sentAt fits on last line variable. Note the check for whether or not our message itself has one line or more than one line. Finally, remember that we owe Flutter a size here, not just knowledge of whether or not sentAt fits onto the last line of the message. To save the actual size of the widget, combine knowledge of whether or not sentAt fits on the last line with the number of lines in the message itself to make the right measurements. Remember, this fully commented code is available below. We have one more task to make sure we didn't just calculate something larger than our available constraints. To do this, we'll use the constrain method on box constraints and save those results to size. And there it is. Perform layout has done its job. We're ready to move on to the next critical method, paint. The first thing to know about paint is that it's called after perform layout. So we should favor the size variable we set in perform layout over the original constraints when making calculations. Paint is passed in two parameters: a painting context, which we'll use to actually draw stuff, and an offset, which is essentially art distance from the upper left corner of the screen. To draw the raw message itself, we can return to our text painter and call paint, passing in context.canvas and offset. This is the first moment our code has been capable of rendering anything, so I'm going to save and run my app. But I do have to tend to one detail I forgot earlier, which is to set an initial string value on our text controller. And there it is, our text centered on the screen, just like if we'd used a simple text widget. So pretty. But this is where things get fun. Back in our RenderObjects paint method, calculate a special offset for the sentAt variable, which adds the extra distance needed to correctly place sentAt in relation to the message text. Finally, call sentAt textpainter.paint, passing in that same context.canvas and our new offset. Save and run our app again, and voila! Our widget is placing all the text correctly. One thing I'm noticing is that the sentAt value isn't gray like we wanted, which is because I forgot to update the timestamped chat message render objects constructor to use our text span helpers. There, that's better. That said, there are a few other problems with our widget. It doesn't yet correctly rebuild itself or participate in Flutter's semantics system, which is used for screen readers and other accessibility tools. First, we'll handle semantics in the third big render object method, describe semantics configuration. Describe semantics configuration accepts a semantics configuration parameter that the render object is supposed to complete. Semantics is a whole other topic in Flutter, so for this, I'll only go as far as to say I took inspiration from Render Paragraph's version of this method when I came up with these lines. That's how you write the three critical methods: perform layout, paint, and describe semantics configuration. However, there's one more detail we have to see to. You see, Flutter calls each of those methods whenever our widget or render object first appear, but it doesn't always know when to call them later on. For that, we need to get familiar with each of those three methods, complementary methods. Mark needs layout, Mark needs paint, and Mark needs semantics update, are methods we call when we've just done something that invalidates the old layout, painting calls, or semantics configuration. But what does that mean? When and where should we call something like Mark needs layout? Well, the rules are actually very simple. Think back to those magic setters we wrote in our render object. Every time we update a variable that was used in perform layout, we call Mark needs layout. If you update something that changed the pixels the paint method drew, call Mark needs paint. And of course, if you change the semantic meaning of your render object, call Mark needs semantics update. Revisit what you wrote in each of the three main methods and notice which of your class variables influenced that method's output. Then, whenever you change those variables, mark that work as stale and in need of an update. Now back to our running app. Typing in new text reveals the final product at last. One detail worth noting is that Mark needs layout encompasses Mark needs paint, so you never need to call both of those. That was a lot of code, but we've reached the finished product. At the outset, we faced a UI that Flutter's single-pass layout algorithm couldn't elegantly handle. But with the power of render objects, learn how to write the necessary imperative code that can juggle back and forth concerns like this and efficiently lay out our app's chat messages. This is a viable render object, though there is more you can add to this class for a more robust implementation, like supporting placing this in an intrinsic widget. But that additional code is in the full source below. In the next episode, we'll build on this knowledge and explore how you'd implement dazzling effects with a custom shader if you didn't have the help of any packages. Leave us a comment below and let us know what you'd like to see in future episodes of The Build Show. And for everything else on Flutter, head to flutter.dev.